Britain is the country that birthed the railway. The first passenger railway ran between Liverpool and Manchester, and Britain was the country to make many advancements in terms of railway transport. But today it can be said that our railways are in rather a sorry state. The most expensive in Europe, always late, sometimes never running, and when they are never on time. Trains were, of course, to begin with, a private service. The railway building mania caused by the success of the Liverpool to Manchester railway caused an explosion in railway construction. The aim was, of course, not to build a national network that would best serve the population, but to make money. In some places, these two things overlapped, and in others, they didn't. Many railways actually had to be forcibly grouped together in 1924 because they were unprofitable on their own. Trains, unlike many forms of utility or service, it can't really be anything other than a monopoly. Proof of this is the 19th century battle between the London Chatham and Dover Railway and the South Eastern Railway. Both railways poached each other's traffic to a ridiculous extent. They both ran into Dover, they both ran into Canterbury. They built two stations in Blackfriars 5 minutes apart, and two stations in Catford about 30 seconds apart. The two lines actually crossed at multiple points. Although building two almost identical railways might sound like an enormous waste of human resources and labour, it might also sound like a libertarian's wet dream. Competition is supposed to drive improvement, but here it had the opposite effect. Because of severe competition and duplication of services, both railways had a problem getting good enough receipts, meaning both services had a reputation for being slow, dirty, and unreliable. Support for nationalised railways in this country has always been around 65-70%. Much like wokeism, EU membership, equality and diversity and multiculturalism, railway privatisation was imposed on the British public against our will by the political class. Peter Hitchens explains that the privatisation of the railways was done against the advice of everyone who knew anything about the subject. Quite predictably, it cost far more in subsidies than the old nationalised system. Many defenders of rail privatisation argue that numbers of people taking trains and overall satisfaction is quite high. Whilst this is true, it is also at the cost of the highest rail subsidies in Europe, most of which are going to the pockets of foreign rail operators. Let's take a step back and think here. Why would companies take on railways anyway? So they can make a profit, of course. Indeed, there is a lot of questions as to why the railways were nationalised in the first place, as the operation as a whole was making the taxpayer a decent profit prior to nationalisation. Privatisation took that profit away and gave it to private businesses, or even worse, foreign governments. Arriva UK Trains, which runs Chiltern Railways, Cross Country, and also the London Overground, as well as a handful of other railways, is actually owned by the German state-owned railway Deutsche Bahn. That's right, the profit from British railways and even subsidies from British taxpayers are effectively paying for the German national railway system. Netherlandse Spoorwegen, which runs Greater Anglia, ScotRail and Merseyrail, as well as East and West Midlands, is also the Dutch nationalised railway provider. A good proportion is also held by Italian and French national rail providers. In fact, 70% of UK rail routes are now wholly or partly owned by foreign states. In effect, British railways are a cash cow for other countries to improve their own rail systems. Not only that, but they don't run them very well. There's a good video from Wendover Productions talking about the running of the Inner City East Coast franchise. The situation with this franchise is that basically for the last 20 years, companies have taken over the railway. Prices soared, they mucked up the running of it, it had to be re-nationalised. When it was run in the public interest, it was run properly, fares went down and it made a profit. Then it was privatised again and surprise, surprise,
imagine my shock!
The same thing happened all over again. Britain has the most privatised railways on the planet. So with their unabashed failure, it's rather unsurprising that the government is moving to re-nationalise them. National Express East Anglia, for example, has an 81% record for on-time trains. This at first glance doesn't look too bad, but nationalised networks on the continent view anything below 98% as incomprehensible, to quote Rüdiger Gruber, the current CEO of Deutsche Bahn. Although I've talked a lot about profitability here, it's my view that trains are a critical infrastructure and therefore should not be designed to make a profit, rather provide a critical service. The mentality of the government should not be that the free market is the answer to all our troubles, but the transport network is a service for its citizens and not a gateway for corporate greed. A lot of problems on this planet have been caused by the motor car, roads ruining landscapes and taking up loads of space, pollution, large metal boxes parked everywhere. Idyllic country villages aren't ruined by train tracks in the same way that they are by big roads. And it's criminally underknown how green trains are. As you can see by the graph, driving a petrol car 1 kilometre will give off around 192 grams of greenhouse gases per passenger. For a train, this is just 41 grams. and on the Eurostar just 8 grams will be produced. They are actually greener than electric cars. Trains are also much better for noise pollution. Peter Hitchens says that privatising the railways finished off most of what was left of our train manufacture. All the claims made for it are bogus. Passenger numbers increased not because of privatisation, but in spite of it, as more and more people were forced by unhinged house prices to commute vast distances to work, and could only do so by train. Hitchens explains that British Rail also subsidised a native industry of locomotive carriage and wagon building, which is now almost entirely extinct. They also managed to maintain the track at night and on Sundays without the level of disruption now common. The electric train is also much less dependent on foreign natural resources, which cars and other forms of transport are. Electricity can be generated domestically from nuclear energy or renewable sources, improving the national economy. This is immediately a conservative practice because the dependency on the rest of the world is significantly reduced. As I pointed out on Twitter, saying that you wanted to privatise the roads and close unprofitable ones would be an immediate source of mockery. Apparently the same is not the case for trains, although in my view it should be. All in all, bring back British Rail and rebuild train lines to every town in Britain.